This is Dr. Lesley de Souza. She's a conservation scientist and an ichthyologist, which means she studies fish, primarily those in South America, and one group in particular, the Arapaima, a genus of freshwater fish that can get up to nearly 10 feet or 3 meters in length. When she's not here at the Field Museum, she's conducting field work in Guyana alongside the indigenous people in the region. Their goal is to create a protected area to ensure a healthy future for the land, water, and people in the country. So we met up with Lesley to talk about her work and to geek out over these incredible fish.
I think it's really interesting that when we think a lot about like rainforest conservation, most people think about saving the trees, but what you're really advocating for is saving these watersheds and saving these aquatic environments.
Essentially, a watershed is a whole river system that's connected to the forest and to the people and every aspect of that natural environment. If you have a headwater system that is flooding a savanna or a forest, anything that's upstream is going to affect anything that's downstream. What fish are doing, especially in these Amazonian systems, is that they migrate into this flooded forest during the rainy season. And so not only do you have to protect the waterways that they use to reproduce, but you have to protect the forest that becomes flooded that are connected to those river systems.
Why Arapaima? I mean, there are so many different diverse species of fishes in the Amazon, and why just focus on one?
The Arapaima in that particular region is endemic, which means it's found there and nowhere else in the world.
Wow.
And their populations were declining. The local people wanted to protect this species. And so together with the local indigenous communities, we started studying their movement patterns. And so as the rainy season comes on, the river floods, and a lot of fish are moving upriver and going into the flooded forest to spawn and have babies and eat food. But the main question that we were trying to get after is, where do they go, and what is the extent of this river drainage are they utilizing?
How do you track that kind of movement?
Oh my goodness. I mean, it was something that had not ever been done for Arapaima yet, using radio telemetry, which is a technique to track and follow fish using a radio transmitter that has a certain frequency and that's connected to a receiver. And essentially what you do is you have an antenna and you can have a radio transmitter inside a fish. You are riding down the river and you're just looking for this fish, and you're looking for the signal of that fish based on the frequency.
Are you putting radio collars on these fish, or what is that whole process?
That's a great question. And what we did on this particular study, radio telemetry study with Arapaima, is that we inserted radio transmitters into the intercoelom, so which is the stomach cavity of the Arapaima.
Yeah.
So here is a very, very small Arapaima, very different than what I'm dealing with in the field. If you look into this bottom area, which there is already an incision, there's a large space because it's a large fish that's essentially at empty. It's like a huge cavity.
Okay.
And then that's where the radio would sit. So we use nets to kind of corral them into a shallow space. We essentially had to wrangle them and hold them. Then we turned over the fish, took out scales, inserted this radio transmitter, sewed them up, and then we monitored that fish for about 24 hours before we left the site.
So inserting the radio transmitter doesn't like severely harm the fish in any kind of way?
I actually had a couple of Arapaima that when I was tracking were actually breeding.
Wow.
And that had babies. So
wow.
To me, that was a very strong indication that they recovered really well from the surgery.
That they're good.
They're all right.
They're doing okay. When you go to work and do research in these areas, you mentioned working with the indigenous communities a lot. And how does that relationship come together? Like, is there a certain skepticism or hesitancy? Like, who is this scientist who's not from here, and why does she want to collect all of our fish?
Yeah. My crews, a lot of times, were made up of the local indigenous communities. For them, it was like, I want to learn how to use a GPS. And I mean, that was really cool. They were like, oh, I want to GPS my farm. But that exchange of knowledge over time led to increased trust. It became a we thing. It was our project. We have an obligation and a responsibility as scientists working in other communities to, you know, bring an understanding of what it is that we're trying to do, whether it's anthropological research or whether it's fish work or turtle work or snake work or whatever. The most important thing that I learned over my time there is that these are the local people that understand this environment better than anybody else in the world. It doesn't matter what I read in a book. It doesn't matter what I understand from here in Chicago. We're in the water with piranhas, with eel, with stingrays.
You're not your everyday fisher.
No, it's not. And like, you know, having a team that is very familiar with the ecosystem, the behavior of these fish, was critical.
You're now involved in trying to create this protected area in Guyana, but what does that actually involve? You just like write a letter to somebody and you're like, you should protect this because I'm Dr. Fish Scientist. I don't know.
We have been meeting with government officials, NGOs, protected areas commissions, ministers, the president, and really making a case for why this area should be protected. And not just for the biodiversity, but from a cultural standpoint and the livelihood of the people that depend on this ecosystem for every aspect of their lives.
That's huge.
That's huge.
That's so huge.
It's so huge. You know, I was always into the work that I've been doing. I've just geeking out on, oh, there's a new species or this fish is related to this one and this like first originated here and now it's here. And I think that there was just another level that I reached that there could be an application for the science that I'm doing. We can only like inform them. That's all we can do. But they're the ones that have the power to do it. And it's like, we have to keep fighting for it.
I think it's great to have fish nerds like you out there fighting the good fight. Thanks, Lesley.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I'm teary-eyed a little bit.
I get really emotional on this show sometimes thinking about fish.
I can't help it. It still has brains on it.